So for today's class, I'll be talking about few left out miscellaneous bacteria. They have been left out because the diseases that they bring about are not that common, or probably they are not worldwide in distribution. But nonetheless, as a student of medicine, you must be at least aware of them, that such a disease exists, such pathogens exist, and this is how the disease process happens, and these are the ways to diagnose them. And you never know which of these might come in the examination as a potential short notes question. So in today's class, I will hopefully be discussing these pathogens. The first one would be Legionella pneumophila. You might recollect that I already spoken about this. This is an organism which is responsible for atypical pneumonia. I'll be talking about that. And then I'll be talking about these two organisms together, Spirillum and Streptobacillus. These two diverse and totally unrelated organisms cause same kind of disease, which is known as the rat bite fever. So rat bite fever can also be a short course question. And thirdly, I'll be talking about Listeria. Listeria bacteria is important because of two types of diseases that it brings about. One is a foodborne illness which manifests as gastroenteritis. And the second one is a more severe kind of disease which manifests as bacteremia, septicemia, or meningitis, especially in neonates, pregnant women, and immunocompromised individuals. So Listeria is important. The question may be asked as Listeriosis. And then I'll be talking on Gardnerella. This gram variable bacterium is responsible for a condition called bacterial vaginosis. So bacterial vaginosis can be a short course question. Now this bacterium alone is not thought to be much of a pathogen, but it's along with a bunch of other organisms, it is thought to be involved in the disease process called vaginosis. It is not vaginitis, it is vaginosis. And then lastly, I'll be speaking on a bacterium called Francisella tularensis. Francisella tularensis is not seen in India. The disease produced by it is called tularemia. It is not seen in India, but it's seen in Western countries, in US, Europe, and so on. It is highly pathogenic bacteria, which could be as dangerous as plague, and it is a bioterrorism agent. So tularemia can also be a short course question. So with this introduction, I'll start talking about each of these bacteria. First, I'll talk on Legionella pneumophila. Since I did not have time to prepare a mind map, you'll have to deal with the PowerPoint slides in the survey that your CR created a couple of days ago. Around 60% of you, 60% of those who polled preferred mind map. But yes, it's a good way. But unfortunately, I do not have that much time to prepare mind maps afresh. So here you are with the PowerPoints. Okay, all right. So I'll start with the first one, that is Legionella pneumophila. It's not pneumoniae, it is pneumophila. The species name is a giveaway. It indicates that it causes a respiratory tract infection. Now, talking about the bacterium, it's a gram-negative pleomorphic bacilli. Pleomorphic. It's aerobic, non-sporing, and is fastidious, so it cannot be grown on simple medium. It belongs to a family called Legionellaceae. There are around 50 species. Of them, 19 are pathogenic, but the species of importance to us is Legionella pneumophila. Other species are of lesser importance. Now, this is a bacterium that is found in environment. It's a saprophytic bacterium. So it is found in the environment, especially in water bodies. It could be a lake, pond, a river. This is in natural environment. In hospital environment, they are found colonizing the water bodies such as humidifiers, water coolers, air conditioners. So these are the potential sources of infection in urban environment, especially in hospitals or in hospitality industries. Say for example, a convention center or a hotel. So those are the places where outbreaks have happened. Now, another specialty of this bacterium is that it has been found inside amoebae. So this can replicate inside protozoan hosts such as amoebae. So perhaps there is a symbiotic relationship, I don't know, but they have been found inside amoebae as well. Okay. Now, of all the species, as I said, up to 90% of human infection caused by a single species, that is Nemophila. There are no animal reservoirs or carriers. Now, what kind of disease does Legionella Nemophila causes? Now, why the name Legionella is because there's a history here. There was an American Legion convention, it's a meeting, you know, there's a conference kind of thing was going on in Philadelphia and USA. And all many of them got infected by this bacterium, which probably happened through the air cooling system. So that is how the name Legionella came about. Okay, coming back to the diseases, Legionella Nemophila is responsible for two kinds of disease, one very mild and the other one is severe. The mild one is known as the Pontiac fever. Pontiac fever is a mild flu-like illness, whereas the other one is the Legionnaire's disease, which is severe interstitial pneumonia. If you look at the mode of infection, it is mainly respiratory. How do people get infected? When they inhale the aerosols, which is generated from contaminated air conditions, nebulizers, humidifiers, or if a person's pharynx is colonized by the bacterium, such oropharyngeal secretions are aspirated, say following hospitalization. A person is comatose and put on artificial respiration, then it's possible that the bacteria which is colonized in the pharynx is then aspirated into the lungs. So these are the routes by which people can get infected. So remember that this can cause both community acquired pneumonia as well as hospital acquired pneumonia. The source of infection in either cases are different. In community acquired pneumonia, it's often the natural water bodies or sometimes the cooling systems, whereas in hospital, it's mostly because of the cooling systems prevalent in the hospital environment or the aspiration of oropharyngeal secretions. The good thing is that the disease is not transmitted from human to human, so there is no human to human transmission. What are the predisposing risk factors? This means who or what are the category of people who are at more at risk of developing severe diseases. So these predisposing risk factors are people who smoking, alcoholism, or who are having some chronic lung disease, the advanced age, that means older people, those people who are on immunosuppressive therapy, any kind of immunosuppressive therapy, who have HIV infection, who have been hospitalized, and are having indwelling tubes in their respiratory tract. So this favors the aspiration of the oral secretions directly into the lower respiratory tract. Okay, now look, if you look at the pathogenesis of the disease, the infection starts by the attachment of the bacterium to the epithelium cells. This is favored either by pili or the presence of outer membrane proteins. Then they are engulfed by the phagocytes. Here, the nature of phagocytosis is quite remarkable in that it is called as a coiling phagocytosis. I show the picture. Here, instead of just putting forth a pseudopodia-like projection, it put forth a coiled structure. This is also seen with Borrelia, which I forgot to mention in that class. So these are the at least two conditions where the phagocytic cells engulf the bacteria by forming by a process called coiling phagocytosis. The speciality of this bacterium is that even after it has been phagocytosed inside a phagosome, its fusion with lysosome doesn't happen. So there is no formation of phagolysosome and the bacteria lives in the phagosome without fusing with the lysosome, and therefore it is able to survive intracellularly. So the bacterium survives intracellularly within the phagocytes. Now, if you look at how the body responds to it, body responds to it by both producing antibodies and CMI. And since the bacteria are located intracellularly within the phagocyte, antibodies can't reach there, so they are not useful. Therefore, only the cell-mediated immunity is protective. Now, if you look at the first one of the two diseases, the Pontiac fever, the milder one, it has an incubation period of just 1 to 2 days and is mild, but the onset can be acute. It's just a flu-like illness with just fever, malaise, headache, and the disease is self-limiting. Most often, people will not even differentiate it from common viral disease. So its rate of infection will hardly be ever known because people hardly go for laboratory diagnosis for a flu-like conditions. The second one is the severe one, that is known as the Legionnaires' disease. Here, the incubation period will be 2 to 10 days. And the Legionnaires' disease is basically an interstitial atypical pneumonia, where I said interstitial space is affected. It is not the alveoli that is affected. So the patients present with non-productive cough. If alveoli were to be infected, there would be productive cough with sputum. So they'll dyspnea, patients will present with dyspnea, chest pain, fever, and sometimes diarrhea. And some patients may also present with confusion or altered mental status. As already stated, Legionnaires' disease is both community acquired as well as nosocomial. So this is a picture which I mentioned, where you can see the coiling phagocytosis. This, the central part, represents the organism which has been engulfed. And this is the phagocyte, which you can see is coiled in nature, and the whole cell is a phagocytic cell. As you can see, this is where the phagocytosis begins. And then it forms a coiled structure within which the bacterium is engulfed. This is coiling phagocytosis. Now, there are various bacteria that are responsible for causing pneumonia in hospitalized patients. So if you look at the nosocomial pneumonia in Western countries from where the data is available, it's believed that up to 50% of nosocomial pneumonia is caused by Legionella pneumophila. And this happens when the hospital's water system is colonized by this bacteria. Now, if you look at the diagnosis of the disease, when the chest X-ray is shown, it shows unilobar, that's only one lobe, patchy infiltrates, which may progress to form consolidation, or in some cases, in 15 to 50% of the individuals, pleural effusion may be seen. So this is the image that we get from the chest X-ray. Now, if you look at the pathogenesis, following infection, the bacteria gains entry into the blood and lymphatics, and from there it goes to disseminate to various organs such as liver, kidney, spleen, heart, bone marrow, even GIT and CNS. Therefore, it is also able to initiate extrapulmonary infections. Remember that Legionella pneumophila is primarily a respiratory pathogen, but at the same time, under certain circumstances, it can also cause extrapulmonary infections such as carditis, pericarditis, and endocarditis, especially in those people who have got artificial heart valves, prosthetic valve endocarditis. It can also cause peritonitis, pyelonephritis, as well as skin and soft tissue infections. There have been cases where post-operative skin infections have been caused by Legionella pneumophila. Now, if you go about laboratory diagnosis, the specimen collected depends on the site of infection. And if it's pulmonary infection, sputum may not be useful all the time. It may not be there. In such cases, you will have to go for the invasive methods of sampling, such as the collection of bronchoalveolar lavage, bronchial washings, or pleural fluid. And what do we do with these samples? These are the different approaches that we have depending on the type of sample that we take. If the blood taken is serum or blood, then the various approaches that we have is either detection of antibodies by ELISA, indirect immunofluorescence, or the detection of bacterial DNA by nucleic acid amplification test such as PCR. So this is the approach that we have with blood or serum. If lower respiratory tract samples are taken, such as sputum, bronchoalveolar lavage, pleural fluid, bronchial aspirations, or lung tissue biopsy are taken, then the options we have are, number one is culture. Number two is nucleic acid amplification by PCR or detection of bacterial antigen in these specimens by performing direct fluorescent antibody test. Now, at the same time, in the urine, bacterial antigen is also excreted. So if you don't want to take any invasive specimens, then the voided urine can also be used for diagnosis, wherein the antigens of Legionella can be detected by immunochromatography or by ELISA. Here, antigen detection by immunochromatography or ELISA in urine specimen can also be done. So if we perform the microscopy, gram stain of sputum is lack sensitivity. It's very feebly stained, is often missed, so it may not even be seen. So not recommended. GIMSA stain can be used. The direct antibody fluorescence, which I said, is very sensitive. And there's one species of Legionella is called Mecadadii, which is mildly acid fast. So this is one bacterium other than Mycobacterium, which can be acid fast. Now, how do we culture this bacterium? The gold standard of culture of this bacterium is BCYE agar. BCYE stands for buffered charcoal yeast extract agar. So this has been a standard medium to isolate Legionella pneumophila from respiratory secretions or samples taken from the respiratory tract. It's incubated at 35 degrees in a humidified environment with 2.5% carbon dioxide. Some textbooks use 5%, so you may say 2.5 to 5% carbon dioxide, and the growth is seen in 3 to 5 days. Now, there's a particular appearance of the colonies. It is said to be iridescent. The colonies are said to be iridescent and granular. So it looks like ground glass appearance. When I say ground glass appearance, you know, you see that matte appearance, you know, not the glossy appearance, not the shining glossy appearance, but the rough matte appearance. So that is how the colonies appear. That is why the colonies are called as a ground glass appearance. The speciality of Legionella is that many species, around 15 to 16 species of Legionella, can fluoresce when exposed to the long wavelength of ultraviolet light. Some of them appear bluish green, some of them appear red. So using UV light can be helpful in identifying Legionella in cultures. If you go about serology, if cultures are not available, then antibodies can be detected, as I stated earlier, by two types of tests. One is indirect immunofluorescence. This is detection of antibody, or by ELISA. There are two ways here. Either you look for a single titer, or you can go for fourfold rise in titer. That means if the patient presents with a titer of more than 1 in 128, there is no need to do any repetition test. This is itself significant. More than 1 in 128 is indicative of active disease. If the titers are less than this, then you will have to collect one more sample of serum a week or two later, and then perform the test in between these two samples, which is called the paired sera. One is taken in the acute phase and the other in the convalescent phase. And if you are able to demonstrate a rise in titer by four folds, then it becomes significant. As already stated, if not antibodies, antigen can be detected in concentrated urine sample, that a urine sample, voided urine sample is taken and concentrated and looked for antigen by either ELISA or by immunochromatography test. ELISA will take a couple of hours, whereas lateral flow immunochromatography test are rapid in nature. Alternatively, if provisions are available, nucleic acid detections can be performed by PCR tests. So on the left here, you can see the respiratory tract sample that has been stained by a fluorescent antibody labeled fluorescent dye, and you can see them fluorescing brightly. On the right side, you can see buffered charcoal yeast extract agar. That's why it's black in color, because charcoal is there. This shows ground glass appearance colonies. All right, then we move on to the next disease. This disease is called as the rat bite fever. As the name itself indicates, the disease is transmitted mainly, but not just limited to, through the bite of infected rats. Remember, that is not the only way of transfer. Now, this disease is known by different names in different geographical locations and is caused by two totally different and unrelated bacteria. The two bacteria are Streptobacillus monoliformis and Spirillum minus. Streptobacillus monoliformis and Spirillum minus. These are the two bacteria which are responsible for similar kind of disease, which is known as rat bite fever. This rat bite fever is known as Haverhill fever in USA and Sodoku disease in Japan. Let me repeat it. In USA, it is known as Haverhill fever, and in Japan, it is known as Sodoku. As I stated, it is caused by two different types of bacteria. I'll introduce those two bacteria to you. First, I'll talk about the Streptobacillus. Streptobacillus, easy to remember. The word bacillus means it is a rod-shaped bacterium, and strepto means it's chain. So usually when we say streptococci, we mean cocci occurring in chains. So streptobacilli means bacilli occurring in chains. So remember this question in examination. If somebody asks you, give examples of bacilli in chains, remember the answer should be streptobacillus. So this is a genus of fastidious bacteria. They were difficult to grow. It's microaerophilic, normotile, and it's gram-negative pleomorphic bacteria belonging to the family called Leptotrichiae. The speciality of this bacterium is that it readily undergoes formation of L forms. If you recollect, in my previous class, I introduced to you about the L forms, where I said these bacteria lose their cell wall spontaneously and become bizarre shaped cells. So you have a chain of bacilli which may contain some bacteria in bacilli and some may be swollen shaped because they would have become L forms. So in the Lister Institute, these were discovered first in this bacterium. L forms are called so because it was discovered in Lister Institute, and the bacterium in which this phenomena was observed was Streptobacillus monoliformis. Okay, and these L forms is not stable. They can revert back, especially when grown on solid medium, into cell wall containing forms. But that was about the Streptobacillus. The second bacterium is Spirillum. As the name indicates, it's a spiral bacterium. It's a rigid spiral gram-negative bacteria belonging to the family Spirillaceae. Whereas the Streptobacillus is non-motile, Spirillum is motile, which can have tuft of flagella depending on the species, either at one end called Lophotrichus or at both ends called Amphitrichus. So when the question is asked about the Lophotrichus or Amphitrichus bacteria, remember the example of Spirillum. Now, where are these bacteria found? Both of these bacteria, Spirillum minus and Streptobacillus monoliformis, are found as normal flora in the oral cavity of rats. So the rats are colonized by these organisms, and most infections are transmitted through the bites of these rats. Okay, now Streptobacillus monoliformis can also be transmitted through consumption of water that has been infested by rats. So it can also be transferred when people come in close contact with rats or they handle rats. But this mode of transmission is restricted only to Streptobacillus monoliformis, but not Spirillum minus. So both of them are transmitted through the rat bites. In addition, Streptobacillus monoliformis can also be transmitted through consumption of infected water and with close contact or handling of rats. So these are the two pictures here. On the left side, you see bacilli occurring in chain, although the typical appearance is not quite seen here because most of them have taken bizarre shapes. See, as you can look, see here, this is a chain here. These two are okay, whereas these have swollen. Look here. They have taken swollen appearance because they have turned into L forms. On the right side, you see spiral bacteria. See spiral bacteria, which are having flagella in this case on either ends. It can either be single flagellum or it can be a tuft of flagella. So these are spirilla. Spirilla is plural. Spirillum is singular. As I already stated, the disease is known by different names. That caused by Streptococcus pneumoniformis is known as Haverhill fever in USA, and the disease caused by Spirillum minus in Japan is called Sodoku. Why the name Sodoku? In Japanese, so means rat and doku means poison. There's no poison coming from the rat, but it was believed that something obnoxious is coming from the rats. So the Streptococcus pneumoniformis rat bite fever in USA is known as Haverhill fever, where the same disease caused by Spirilla minus in Japan is called Sodoku. There's a slight variation in the incubation period. The incubation period of the rat bite fever caused by Streptobacillus pneumoniformis is shorter. It is 7 to 10 days, whereas that for Spirilla minus is longer, at a 1 to 3 weeks. The disease presentation is more or less similar in either of the case. It is characterized by abrupt onset of fever with chills and headache. Most importantly, at the site of the rat bite, there will be an inflamed, painful, ulcerated wound. So at the site of rat bite, there will be an inflamed, tender, ulcerated wound. And most significant finding is appearance of maculopapular or petechial rash, which can be itchy, urticarial, And then in one category of patient, there will be painful polyarthritis affecting several joints. This is mainly seen with infection caused by Streptobacillus pneumoniformis. And arthritis is not seen or very less in disease caused by Spirillum minus. Now this disease is recurring. In untreated patients, high fever and symptomatic disease lasts for 3 to 7 days, and then after a week of the disease, it can remit. The disease can reoccur 3 to 10 days later, following by such recurring cycles for 3 to 8 weeks. So the patient may have disease, then the patient may become fine, and then the disease may recur. So this can be relapsing disease. Not just this, sometimes the disease can become severe, where the patient may present with pneumonia, meningitis, or myocarditis. And in those patients who already have some pre-existing valvular disease, this disease affecting their walls, they can develop endocarditis. And one characteristic feature which is specific to the disease caused by Spirilla minus is the development of lymphadenopathy. So lymphadenopathy is seen in case of Spirilla minus, but not seen in case of Streptobacillus pneumoniformis. Similarly, polyarthritis is seen in case of Streptobacillus pneumoniformis, but not seen with Spirilla minus. So these are the differences. When this question is asked, you will have to draw a table of differences between these two conditions. If you go for the laboratory diagnosis, the sample collected are lymph node aspirate if it is Sodoku, and the choice of sample for either of the conditions is blood. Spirilla minus has not been cultured on artificial culture medium. Streptobacillus pneumoniformis can be cultured on blood containing medium, whereas Spirilla minus cannot be cultured. And how do you demonstrate them? You can demonstrate Streptobacillus minus in the samples by dark field microscopy, or prepare a smear and stain with either the Wright stain or the Jameson stain, or inoculate the organism into the guinea pig, and 2 to 3 weeks later you can identify the bacteria in the blood of the guinea pig. So this is not done routinely. So routinely what can be done is dark field microscope, if the microscope is available, or smear stained by Wright or Jameson. If we talk about the Streptobacillus monoliformis, that is the laboratory diagnosis of Haber Hill fever, the bacterium can be cultured on blood containing medium. It requires not 5% of blood, but 10 to 20% of blood will be required. Additionally, serum, egg yolk, and starch can improve the growth. The plates are incubated aerobically at 37 degrees. No serological tests are available for either of these bacterial disease. Therefore, these are the only methods available. And the one good thing is that both of the diseases, I mean, whether it is caused by Streptobacillus or Spirillum, they can be treated by penicillin. In those people who are sensitive to penicillin, that is allergic to penicillin, alternative drugs include doxycycline, tetracycline, or cephalosporins. Now coming to the next organism, Listeria monocytogenes. What should you associate Listeria monocytogenes with? What should come to your mind? One thing that should come to your mind is that Listeria is an environmental organism. It can grow at a variety of conditions. It can grow at low temperature. It can grow in salty environment. It can grow in acidic environment. What does that mean to us? It means it can grow in our food. And therefore, it can survive in our food and cause foodborne infection. So this is one thing. It causes gastroenteritis. It causes severe diseases in the two ends of the age, that is in young age and in the old or elderly people, and in immunocompromised and pregnant people. Listeria monocytogenes is a gram-positive bacillus. It's facultatively anaerobic. A peculiar property of this bacterium is that it exhibits a property which is known as differential motility. That means it is motile at room temperature but non-motile at 37 degrees. So this feature can be used to detect this bacterium, and when observed under microscope, this demonstrates a peculiar type of motility which is described as end-on motility or tumbling type of motility. So that is something specific to this, can be asked in viva. There are 17 species in Listeria genus, but of them all, it is only the Listeria monocytogenes that is important to us. This bacterium is a saprophyte. It thrives in various environmental conditions. It can be isolated from water, soil, and any decaying, decomposing matter. This is what is meant by detritus. And in the natural environment, it is responsible to cause several animal diseases. It's versatile in that it can grow at low temperature. When I say low temperature, it can grow in refrigerating conditions. That is, even at 4 degrees, this bacterium can grow. So therefore, it can cause food spoilage or can persist in refrigerated food also. At the same time, ability to survive in low pH and high salt concentration indicate that it can survive in food. So that is a property which helps it to survive and contaminate the food. The mode of transmission is through ingestion of contaminated food. It can also be transmitted from mother to the newborn child. The infection, the bacterium can also transmit, it can also cross over the placenta and infect the fetus. At the same time, the bacterium also, which is known to colonize the female genital tract, when a child is born through such a genital tract, the newborn can get infected. A newborn can get infected when it passes through the infected birth canal, or it can also get infected from the environment few days later after the birth. So these are the two modes of transmission: ingestion and vertical transmission. We'll see both of them. Any age group can be affected, but as I said, stated, this is seen in the two ends of the spectrum of disease, that is, it is in neonates and in the elderly people and in immunocompromised people and in pregnant women. The commonest type of disease presentation is gastroenteritis. It is foodborne gastroenteritis, and this is usually sporadic, reported here and there. It's very rare that you see an outbreak. When the food is consumed by healthy people, it may require a heavy load of around 10 raised to 9 bacteria, which can cause anything from mild gastroenteritis or even severe gastroenteritis. But if the people who consume such contaminated food happen to be either children, elderly people, or immunocompromised people, then the number of bacteria in the food is around 10 raised to 2 to 10 raised to 4. And then not just gastroenteritis, it can lead to sepsis and even meningitis. So remember that in young and healthy people, consumption of contaminated food can lead to gastroenteritis, which can be just mild or can get severe. But in people who are either children or elderly or immunocompromised, even a small dose of bacteria is sufficient to initiate the disease, which can go on to form sepsis or meningitis. The food that are incriminated are the contaminated cheese, packaged meat, milk, salads, especially those which are kept at 4 degrees. So what happens when the bacteria are ingested in the food? They bind to the epithelium with the help of adhesins called internalins. And then they cross into the lamina propria, get into the lymphatics, and they reach the blood. And from the blood, they go to the target organs, which are the spleen and liver. And here you have to remember one thing is that if the patient happens to be immunocompromised or it's a neonate, then the bacterium is able to cross the blood-brain barrier and initiate CNS infection. If the infection is happening in a pregnant woman, the bacterium can cross the fetoplacental barrier and infect the fetus. Remember these 2 points here. In neonates and immunocompromised, the bacteria can cross blood-brain barrier. And in pregnant women, the bacterium can cross the fetoplacental barrier and infect the fetus. So this is a picture which shows the target organs which are affected by the bacterium. The spleen and the liver are the primary organs where it multiplies. And in immunocompromised neonates, it can go to the CNS. In pregnant women, it can go into the fetus. So once the contaminated food is ingested from the intestine, gets into the lymph node, from the lymph node to the blood vessels, the bacteria are seeded into the liver and the spleen. And then, depending on the type of the patient, it can either go into the brain or it can go and affect the fetus. The speciality of this bacterium is called cell-to-cell mobility. It's a very peculiar feature of this bacterium. Look at this picture. The bacterium is taken up inside a vacuole, and then it has the ability, just forget everything else, just concentrate what I'm showing here. This is an epithelial cell. The bacterium gains entry into the cell in a vacuole. It releases itself from the vacuole, and then it polymerizes the cytoskeleton of the host, which is the actin, and uses that actin to propel itself by forming long actin filament chains and propels itself to go and infect the neighboring cell. So this is called as the cell-to-cell spread. When a bacterium engages in cell-to-cell spread, antibodies can't reach it. At the same time, the bacterium has the ability to now go outside the cell or go from one cell to another cell. So the bacterium is internalized into a vacuole. It releases itself from the vacuole by lysing it, by forming pores that it produces a toxin called as listeriolysin O. This toxin helps it to release itself from the vacuole, and then It multiplies in the cytoplasm and moves out. As you can see, it moves out, or it can move to another cell by cell-to-cell spread. How? Actin-based motility. This is a very specific thing about Listeria. Now let us examine the clinical presentation here. Listeriosis. The disease caused by Listeria is called Listeriosis. As I already said, gastroenteritis is one form of Listeriosis. Now I'll talk about the severe form. I'll talk about neonatal Listeriosis. There are two types of neonatal Listeriosis. One is early infection and the other is late infection. Early infection or early onset neonatal Listeriosis. Early onset means within 5 days of birth. The second type of neonatal Listeriosis is late onset. The late onset neonatal Listeriosis is a disease which manifests 5 days after birth. 5 days before is early, 5 days later is late onset. Now, why is the difference here? When the infection is acquired from the mother, that is when the fetus passes through the infected birth canal and the child is born, then the infection is acquired instantly from the mother. Therefore, it is early onset. This is manifest in 5 days. Once the child is born and then it gets infected from the hospital environment, then it is late onset. Early a form of disease is associated with sepsis, whereas late neonatal Listeriosis is associated with meningitis. So remember that when we talk of neonatal meningitis, you have to remember three organisms responsible for neonatal meningitis. There could be more, but the three commonest ones are E. coli, group B streptococcus, and three is Listeria monocytogenes. And when I say Listeria monocytogenes, it is a late onset disease which occurs in a neonate 5 days after birth and infection is acquired mostly from the environment. Now, in the early form of disease where the neonate suffer from sepsis, the mortality rate is high, it is 30%. Whereas the late form of disease, which is characterized by neonatal meningitis, the mortality rate is less than 10%. And there is a severe condition of Listeriosis which is known as granulomatosis infantiseptica. Granulomatosis infantiseptica. So this is sepsis seen in infants and is characterized by granuloma. So this is seen in infants, and what you see here is miliary. Miliary means small, millet-like, small microabscesses. And granuloma. Where are they seen? They are seen on skin, liver, and spleen. So this condition is called granulomatosis infantiseptica. So this is about the infection that is happening in the neonates. But what about infection that is happening in adults? If the infection happens of a pregnant woman, the maternal infection may lead to bacteremia and meningitis in herself. If the bacterium crosses over the placenta and infects the fetus, it can result in abortion or preterm delivery, or may predispose to early onset neonatal disease in the newborn. Now, in adult, otherwise adult men or women, it can cause bacteremia and meningitis, especially in the immunocompromised individuals. Otherwise, it can be asymptomatic. Now, how do we go about laboratory diagnosis? The sample collected include blood and CSF, and in pregnant women, amniotic fluid. What are the methods that are available for laboratory diagnosis? Gram staining. So when gram staining is performed on these samples, you may find gram positive short bacilli, short and stout bacilli, which sometimes get confused with diphtheroids. Now, if you recall, diphtheroids are non-pathogenic or commensal species of Corynebacterium. They are present on the skin. So Listeria monocytogenes has similar morphology, and it is possible that the laboratory may neglect or discard listeria by misidentifying it as diphtheroids. So therefore, it is possible that several cases of listeriosis may go undiagnosed because of this error. Anyway, if you want to confirm that this is indeed listeria, then you can go for differential motility test, wherein you can detect tumbling type motility at room temperature, that is 25 degrees, but not at 37 degrees. This bacterium can be grown on blood agar and chocolate agar. It can be hemolytic on blood agar. And there is another selective medium called PyChem, which is a combination of variety of chemicals and antibiotics. This is selective medium. This is quite useful when you are trying to isolate the bacterium from the environment or the food. Now, for isolation of the bacterium from the food, you can use a method called as a cold enrichment method. Please note that cold enrichment method is performed for two bacteria. One is Listeria monocytogens and the other one is Yersinia enterocolitica. Listeria monocytogens and Yersinia enterocolitica, both of these can cause foodborne illness, and both of these bacteria are able to survive 4 degrees. So keeping the food at 4 degrees will allow the bacteria to multiply, and this enrichment technique is used for detection of these two bacteria in food. This is called cold enrichment method. So the tryptychia soy broth is inoculated and then kept at 4 degrees and then subcultured on solid medium. So only the listerium will grow here. Other properties of this bacterium is that it can grow in a medium up to 10% NaCl, so that will help it to identify the bacterium. And another property of listeria is that it is positive by CAMP test. Remember, the CAMP test positivity is something that we use for group B streptococcus. So if somebody asks you which are the other bacteria that use a CAMP test positive, remember listeria monocytogens. If you talk about the treatment, the antibiotic of choice is basically a combination of ampicillin with gentamicin. Alternatively, in people with sensitivity or allergy to penicillin, cotrimoxazole can be given. And in a patient with febrile gastroenteritis, especially those who are immunocompromised, the drug here is amoxicillin. So this is about the listeriosis. So this is a picture that shows gram-positive short and stumpy bacilli. And then here it's the colonies on blood agar. Okay, so now I have two more bacteria to discuss. One is Gardnerella vaginalis and the other one is Francisella tularensis. Now, what is the significance of Gardnerella vaginalis? Remember here that this bacterium, it's not clear whether it is gram positive or gram negative because it displays what is known as variable gram staining. That means sometimes it may appear gram positive, sometimes it may appear gram negative. Because it has got lipopolysaccharide, it is thought to be gram negative, but gram variability is a constant feature. This bacterium is present as a normal flora in the vagina. So under certain circumstances, this bacterium is able to cause vaginosis. And in patients with vaginosis, Gardnerella is not the sole bacterium that can be isolated. There are a couple of other anaerobic bacteria. So it is polymicrobial in nature. So let's examine this now. Gardnerella vaginalis is thought to be gram-negative because of the lipopolysaccharide present in its cell wall, but is gram-variable. It's facultatively anaerobic, it's non-motile, non-sporing, and pleomorphic coccobacilli. It belongs to the family Bifidobacteriaceae. It's a normal flora of vagina. And it also possesses metachromatic granules. So another example of bacterium possessing metachromatic granules. Remember Spirillum also. Spirillum, which I forgot to mention, is another bacterium which also possesses metachromatic granules. Okay, but this bacterium was previously called as Corynebacterium vaginale or Haemophilus vaginalis. So in cases with vaginosis, it is often isolated with another gram-positive bacterium known as Mobiluncus. There are more. So vaginosis is seen in women of reproductive age. In such cases where women are suffering from vaginosis, the vaginal flora, when it is examined, is thought to comprise of other bacteria, so other means including Gardnerella vaginalis, Mobiluncus, Prevotella, and Peptostreptococcus. All these are anaerobic bacteria. And a characteristic observation that is seen is that there is a decrease in lactobacilli. As long as the vaginal epithelium is colonized by lactobacillus, it is healthy. When this bacterium is replaced by other bacteria such as Gardnerella, Mobiluncus, Prevotella, Peptostreptococcus, and even Mycoplasma hominis, it predisposes to vaginosis. So vaginosis is a condition of infection without inflammation. If there is inflammation, we would call it vaginitis. And vaginitis is caused by a fungus called Candida and a protozoa called Trichomonas vaginalis. But here it is vaginosis where there is no inflammation. Okay. So what are the risk factors for developing vaginosis? So it is seen in persons with some other infections, coexisting infection, that the person, that the woman could be HIV positive, she could be also having gonorrhea, or she could be having genital infections by chlamydia. Or it can also happen in women who frequently douch their vagina. That is, douching means using a jet of a stream or a jet of water to cleanse the vagina. In such women who frequently tend to clean themselves by a stream of water, they tend to be more predisposed to vaginosis because they remove all the helpful bacteria. Or it can be seen in cases where there's a premature rupture of membrane or there is a preterm labor. So these are the risk factors which can promote vaginosis. As I already stated, it's called vaginosis because there's no inflammation of the vaginal epithelium. Now, how do you diagnose vaginosis? What are the criteria for diagnosis? This is prescribed by AMSL's criteria, which states that there must be at least three of the following four criteria to diagnose it as vaginosis, which are these four criteria. One, there must be profuse and thin, not thick or purulent, thin, white homogeneous discharge, which is uniformly coated on the vaginal wall. This is one criteria. Two, the pH must be elevated beyond 4.5. The normal range of vaginal pH is 3.8 to 4.5. If the pH is more than 4.5, then this is one of the criteria. So therefore, measurement of the pH is one of the tests to be done. Then there is a test called the whiff test here. Now here, the vaginal secretions are collected on a slide to which a drop of 10% potassium hydroxide is added. To the vaginal secretion, if a drop of 10% potassium hydroxide is added, a distinct fishy odor appears. And this distinct fishy odor appearance is due to the release of volatile amine such as trimethylamine. So this causes the fishy odor, and this test is known as the whiff test. And the fourth criteria is when a smear is made and stained for GIMSA or papanicolaou and observed under the microscope, you should notice clue cells. What are clue cells? Clue cells are vaginal epithelial cells which are granular in nature, and their border is now indistinct. So the border is not distinct or clear. So the border is now not clear because it is fully studded by bacteria. The whole cell is completely studded by small bacteria. And then what is missing? Lactobacilli are missing. So this gives a picture of possible vaginosis. So such a cell is called as a clue cell. It gives a clue that this could be a case of vaginosis. I'll show you the picture, you'll understand that better. Now, Gardnerella rarely can also cause bacteremia or meningitis. Remember, this is very rare. And men who are having unprotected sexual intercourse with women having vaginosis are at risk of developing urinary tract infection. Whatever may be the infection, it can be treated with oral metronidazole. Remember, metronidazole is a drug of choice for treating several anaerobic bacteria. So this is a wet mount which shows a clue cell. As you can see, these are the two vaginal epithelial cells. Look at its border. You can hear the border is distinct here. You can make out the border, but here the border is not distinct. And the whole cell is covered with plenty and plenty of small bacteria. So this is how it appears on a wet mount. Let's see the gram stain. Look on the right side. This is a healthy vagina picture where you see epithelial squamous epithelial cells which are having gram positive bacilli, which is lactobacillus. Whereas if you look at the case of vaginosis, you can see the border is indistinct, not clear. Lactobacilli are missing. And the whole cell is dotted with plenty of small gram negative or gram positive or gram variable bacteria here. As you can see here, some of them are gram negative, some of them are gram positive. So this is a picture of clue cell. Now coming to the last organism, that is Francisella tularensis, the bacterium which causes tularemia. Now this is important because it is a bioterrorism agent and it's highly infectious. It is dangerous to work in laboratory. And it can cause severe infection, but not seen in India. So this is basically a gram-negative coccobacillus, which is aerobic, non-motile, non-sporing. It has a capsule, just like Yersinia. Previously, it was thought to be related to Yersinia, but it is not. And it is fastidious, so it cannot grow on simple medium. And it displays bipolar appearance. Remember, Yersinia pestis also displays bipolar appearance. So these two bacteria for a very long time were considered together, but now we know they're separate. So it infects a variety of mammals, especially the rodents, lagomorphs. What are lagomorphs? Lagomorphs are those class of rodents which have got two upper teeth and one lower teeth, you know, like hare, rabbit, and so on. So it is predominantly affecting these animals and other rodents, which serve as reservoirs. So it's mainly seen in the Americas, Scandinavian countries of Europe, Eastern Europe, and Siberia. So human disease is actually a zoonosis. People get infected when they come in contact with infected animals or through the bite of ticks. So when ticks feed on infected animals, they get infected, and the bite of ticks can also cause this, cause the transmission of this bacterium. It's highly infective and it's categorized as a class A bioterrorism agent. So apart from close contact with animals or tick bite, it can also be transmitted through inhalation of aerosols. Aerosol inhalation happens usually in laboratory when you're working with the blood samples or the culture of bacteria, or ingestion of contaminated food or water, or the other ways through which infection can happen. The two serotypes, so the Jellison type A and B. Type A is more virulent. The disease tularemia is presenting is in five different forms, so six different forms. So tularemia presents itself in six different forms. These are ulceroglandular, pneumonic, oculoglandular, oropharyngeal, just glandular, and typhoidal. We'll look at each of them in brief. Ulceroglandular means this is the most commonest form. There is an ulcer at the site of inoculation with regional lymphadenopathy. So both an enlarged lymph node and ulcer at the point of inoculation. Pneumonic. This is a pulmonary infection which presents as pneumonia. This happens when the bacteria is inhaled through inhalation of aerosols. This usually happens while working in laboratory. Or it can also happen when the patient is having bacteremia and from the blood it goes to the lungs. So these are the two ways by which the bacteria reaches the lung. Then you have got oculoglandular, as the name indicates, combination of both conjunctivitis and lymphadenopathy. So that the patient may present with purulent conjunctivitis with preauricular lymphadenopathy. Very characteristic, I'll show you the picture here, preauricular lymphadenopathy. And then you have oropharyngeal. So there is pharyngitis, membranous pharyngitis, and with cervical lymphadenopathy. This usually happens when people ingest the organism through uncooked contaminated meat, or when people drink water that is contaminated by lemming excreta. Lemming is a small rat-like rodent. When the water is contaminated by infected lemming, this is also known as lemming fever. So these are the different presentation, and then there is one presentation where it's just glandular, you see only lymphadenopathy, or you have a typhoidal which may mimic typhoid fever. So these are the various pictures. As you can see here, this is the glandular one. This is probably oropharyngeal. You see regional cervical lymphadenopathy. And this is a case of ocular infection where you have both the infection conjunctivitis of the eye as well as preauricular. See in front of the preauricular. And this is ulcerative tularemia, very local lesion. Now, if you talk about the lab diagnosis, sample collected of blood, ulcer scrapings, lymph node biopsy, gastric washings, or sputum as the case may be. It can be cultured on culture media, which is glucose, cysteine glucose blood agar, or you can use enriched chocolate agar or buffered charcoal extract agar incubated aerobically for 2 to 4 days at 37 degrees. Remember, it must be handled only in biosafety level 3 laboratories because it's highly infectious. The bacterium can be identified by performing direct fluorescent antibody test where its antigen can be detected. But most laboratories don't do this because it's highly dangerous. Instead, we can go for antibody detection by latex agglutination or tube agglutination or ELISA test. So killed vaccines are available in some places where the disease is endemic, and treatment includes the use of aminoglycosides such as streptomycin and gentamicin. So this is all that I had to talk about Francisella tularensis. With that, I finished my class on miscellaneous bacteria.